We have for you this evening what promises to be a very provocative and interesting discussion. It features Tyler Cowen and his new book, The Complacent Class, The Self-Defeating Quest for the American Dream. Now, many of you are no doubt already familiar with Tyler, who's been a frequent commentator and writer on economics. He has a doctorate in economics from Harvard and holds a chair in economics at George Mason, where he's been teaching since 1989. He also runs the university's Mercatus Center. Did I pronounce that right,
Tom?
Yes, okay. Which is a libertarian think tank. And he contributes quite frequently to the popular economics blog, marginalrevolution.com. Somewhere along the way, too, he's found time to write several books and has been widely published in academic journals and the popular media. In his new book, Tyler argues that the innovation and dynamism, the sense of restlessness and willingness to take risks that historically have driven America have faded, where now he contends a nation more focused on safety and predictability, on seeking comfort and clustering together like in like-minded communities. In the process, Tyler says, our society has stagnated, become less willing, say, to start new companies or interact with others who are different from us. And the result has been slower economic growth and mounting frustration over a lack of opportunity. Now, Tyler dedicated his book, quote, to the rebel in each of us, and makes the case that we need to snap out of our complacency or else be prepared for some serious disruptions, social explosions, and renewed instability. As signals that deep currents in America today may be building towards ruptures, Tyler points to developments ranging from the nationwide protests over police brutality to the election of Donald Trump, and I'm sure we'll have more to hear more about that this evening. If all this sounds pretty disturbing, it was meant to be. This certainly isn't a feel-good book, but a review in National Journal called The Complacent Class, quote, one of the most important reads of the new year, and a review in Kirk has predicted the book, quote, will undoubtedly stir discussion, as many of Cowen's books do, with readers divided about how they stand based on where they currently sit. Now, sitting with Tyler this evening and here to engage him is another very lively thinker and skilled debater, Derek Thompson, a senior editor at The Atlantic who writes about economics, technology, and pop culture, and who himself is a frequent TV commentator. Derek also has just come out with a new book, Hitmakers, which he spoke about here at PNP earlier this month. The book examines why some things become big hits and other things don't. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Tyler Cowen and Derek Thompson.
Thank you all very much. Tyler, let's jump right in. Who is the complacent class? And feel free, of course, to point out individual members in the audience if you'd like.
We are the complacent class. And when I dedicated the book to the rebel in each of us, actually, I was teasing all of you. If you look at the data for Americans as a whole, how much they save in terms of safe assets, how frequently they move across state lines, what is the chance they medicate themselves? How willing are they to simply let their children play outside? And what are our rates of productivity growth, innovation, startups, and switching jobs? I know what you read sometimes, but those are all down. So overall, this is a portrait of a quiescent America in a kind of slow decline with a lot of safety and security, and it does feel good. That's exactly the danger. It feels good for most of us, but collectively, eventually, the bill comes due when you stop being dynamic.
I can see the genesis of this book in one of your earlier books, The Great Stagnation. You write here that peace and high incomes tend to drain the restlessness out of people. I wonder, to a certain extent, is this a sequel of sorts to The Great Stagnation, if anybody here read that one as well?
It's a sequel to Great Stagnation, but most of all, I think of it as my attempt to provide a contemporary version of Tocqueville's Democracy in America. Now, so often commentary on America compares this country to Western Europe. And if you compare the 50 states to Western Europe, well, we look at least somewhat dynamic, right? We grow more rapidly than they do. We move around somewhat more rapidly than they do. In essence, I'm doing a Tocquevillian take, but through the eyes of China. an inspiration for this book are my numerous trips to China over the last 5 years. How might an America of today look to Chinese eyes? And instead of Europe being the foil, all of a sudden it's the emerging economies.
Throughout the book, you offer a lot of really good empirical evidence that we have become more complacent, we move less, we start fewer companies, and those companies that we do start are less likely to grow into the sort of unicorns that we hear so often about in the press. To dig in a bit to the causes of this, you put a lot of stock in geographical mobility. We used to move around the country a lot more than we do now. There was a period, I think, in the late 19th century when the population of Chicago was quadrupling in a decade. Now the cities seem a little bit more self-same and people are less likely to move. How does this play into our sense of economic complacency?
There are at least two reasons for mobility going down across the states. The first is simply as a nation we're older and older people move around less. The second, I think, is a little harder to see. Economically speaking, different parts of the country, they're more like each other. So if you're a dentist in Columbus, Ohio, you don't think, oh, well, the new frontier for dentistry is Denver, Colorado. I'm going to move there. It's not like the old days where you leave Mississippi for Detroit or later on leave Detroit for Houston. Or a somewhat bland service sector economy, using the internet and cheap travel, you find out pretty early on where you like it and you stay there. By the way, I've been living in Northern Virginia for 27 years. He's the non-complacent one.
I'm not complacent, right, but I've only lived in Washington, D.C. And New York, so I'm not exactly a particular evidence of someone who's moving to brave new places. This is interesting, though, because you know it suggests that I feel like one thing that could be playing a role here is that people might be staying put because they're happier where they are and because potentially, is it possible that use of the internet allows them to figure out where the best place is for them to be, and so maybe there's fewer experimental travel. Someone moving to Chicago, disliking it, Cincinnati, disliking it, Boston, okay, I'll stay here. You're more likely to research where you want to move and then move there. Is there any way that's happening at all?
I think that's exactly right. And then you have Netflix and Amazon. They cement you in wherever you feel you can afford and like the climate. And the reason that you might need to leave, say, Birmingham, Alabama, because some of the amenities are not what you want, that's weaker than it used to be. There's a key contrast in the book. Staying put does typically make individuals happier. That's why they do it. But again, there's a broader societal effect where dynamism, innovation, the ability of our labor market to come back following a recession, those all go down.
One of the other things that you talk about a lot is the surprising decline in entrepreneurship. And I say surprising because I feel like we are living through a period right now, certainly the last 15 years, when entrepreneurship and innovation is a buzzword. It is on the cover of every single magazine and newspaper. And so if the life that you live is one of browsing front pages, you have to think we are living in a heyday of innovation. I certainly see the word a lot. But the underlying metrics seem to suggest that entrepreneurship is on its way down. Why? And what are some of the reasons why people in a richer society with more access to the internet, which is theoretically a boon to entrepreneurship, are nonetheless not being as innovative as their parents and grandparents' generation?
Information technology, clearly it's a very dynamic sector. It's changed a lot. It's been great. No one can deny that. Keep in mind, a lot of those gains are for our leisure time. Just think of yourself going on Facebook. That actually can even harm productivity in other parts of the economy. So I think a few confluences have come together. There was end of the age of cheap energy, America losing some of its national spirit, regulation in this country going up, sometimes for quite good reasons, not always, but at times. But also, we had exhausted the previous paradigm of bringing together fossil fuels and powerful machines. We did everything we could think of with them, cars and planes and so on. I was a kid, I had a car. Now I still have a car, it's a little better. Think of my grandmother, born in 1905. She didn't have running water, electricity, it was just in the works, cars not really, radio, no. By the time she's 50, in the mid-50s, you have something a bit like modern America. Everything's different, you even have antibiotics. My 50 plus years, things look the same. Watch those old TV shows. You still know how that stuff works. other than, you know, smartphones and some things with computers.
I think you made this point in a previous book. It might have been Average is Over, but it also might have been The Great Stagnation. And it's a point that the economist Bob Gordon makes sometimes, which is if you look at 1950s, 1960s television shows and you watch the characters move through their homes, you compare that to the home that you have now and you think, oh, I have that, I have that, I have that. It's basically the same. All that's changed in terms of innovation in the last, say, three and a half decades, or the vast majority of what's changed, has happened in the kingdom of communications and media, in sort of the Netflix industry. But in travel and in sort of kitchen and home technology, we're basically still living in many ways in the 1950s and 1960s.
My home in Fairfax, it is from about 1960, and we still haven't had a new kitchen put in. I hear about this. From my dear wife over here. But you know, the reason is that it works fine. There's a microwave tacked on, which I still haven't actually learned how to really use. And I can get by. So that's a reflection of stagnancy, that your commute is longer, that we're still flying planes from 1970. So many other sectors of the economy have not advanced that much, and you see this in these fairly stagnant real wages.
So your wife could say with a degree of accuracy that you are very much the complacent class when it comes to kitchen technology and housing.
We've developed a quiz, How Complacent Are You? We did this at Mercatus at George Mason. And I've taken the quiz. In part, I'm writing this book about myself. And one of the warning signs you need to realize is markets are remarkably good at packaging new experiences for you to feel you're so neat and cool and innovative, but you're actually doing the same thing over and over again. So maybe you travel to a lot of different countries, but you do it the same way. You use the same internet search services. I go around different countries. Every place I go, I still want to try their chocolate ice cream. So this blurring of innovation itself into the category of sameness is part of what our contemporary world is about.
And I promise I'm only going to do this once in the entire interview, but this is a theme of my book as well, which is that one of the secrets to pop culture is this interplay between the familiar and the surprising. We love discovering new songs that sound just like the songs that we know and love. We love watching new movies that are sequels, adaptations, and reboots. Even in our industry, I think, we love reading new books and new political essays that express with brilliant new metaphors and jokes those ideas that we've already intuited and often hope are true. And so in many ways, the cultural economy is a machine for producing products that deliver in wonderful and surprising and ostensibly new ways all the most familiar feelings that we've always wanted to have.
I'm a big fan of Derek's new book. It's great. I read it the first day they sent it to me. It's called Hitmakers. And the same idea about the tensions between conservatism and innovation, they're actually underlying themes in both of our books. And I like to think someone brilliant up there knew that. And that's why they paired us together.
Thank you, everyone. Have to talk about NIMBYism and the argument that one reason why a lot of young people in particular are not moving so much is because the places that they want to move to, Washington, D.C., New York City, San Francisco, Seattle, Portland, have become so expensive in the last 15 years that it's priced out a lot of middle and lower income young people, or even upper middle class young people with lots of student debt. To what extent is our innovation problem simply a problem of lack of housing growth?
It's a major factor. To move into a normal, non-glamorous apartment in San Francisco today can cost you $4,000 or $5,000 a month or more. If you go back to American movies, American fiction of the 50s or even 60s, it's a common story. No one laughs. There's some fellow, he's ambitious, upwardly mobile. He moves to Manhattan, gets a room in a flop house, like on Fifth Avenue or on Broadway, or maybe if times are really tough, like Seventh Avenue. And he works his way up, you know, paying rent in this flop house. It's only a few dollars. Those days are gone. Even Washington, it used to be the cheap city. It's still cheaper than Boston or Manhattan. But that's disappearing rapidly. And so wealthy people live next to each other much more than they used to. Democrats or Republicans live next to each other more than they used to, the highly educated. We are becoming a much more segregated society. We do it because for the people who are better off, it's comfortable. And probably, again, in this way, each and every rebel in this audience is just a bit the complacent class.
I'm not going to make you recite the entire thesis of The Big Short all over again, but I am in particular interested in why you think this has changed. What's changed between the decade when it was possible for that young, ambitious 23-year-old to move into the flophouse in Manhattan, and today when such a prospect is unbelievably unrealistic because that same apartment is going to cost him $2,500 a month?
In general terms, all systems slow down and ossify, but there are also some particular reasons for what happened. So the more homeowners are established, they learn how to organize, they exert closer control over their local or state governments, they restrict the supply of housing to keep the value of their house high or to keep out quote-unquote undesirables, they get better and better at getting their kid into the right school, and simply they adjust more over time, and those adjustments enacted collectively mean a slowing down of change.
It's interesting because this is one of the areas, or one of the ways at least, in which liberals can be sometimes the most conservative. That you look at the cities that have the highest housing costs, and you look at some of the NIMBY policies that exist in San Francisco and New York and even Washington, D.C., Boston to a certain extent. You have people that are liberal-minded, that vote for the Democrats consistently, that support welfare policies, but at the same time, support local housing policies that keep many of those welfare recipients out of their districts, out of their neighborhood, or far away from their neighborhood, which can have all sorts of blowback. A, it means that they're concentrated in parts of the country that has lower productivity, and so it hurts them. Or B, you have a situation like the 2016 election when you have such self-segregation that none of the liberals know anybody who voted for Donald Trump, and none of the Donald Trump supporters know anybody who voted for Clinton. Do you think that, why do you think it is that liberals, that coastal liberals, are sometimes the most conservative when it comes to NIMBY policies?
They've built nice, wonderful places and cities, like parts of Austin, a lot of Ann Arbor. But if you look at the data, one of the least segregated states in this country is West Virginia. Is it that people in West Virginia are so much more wonderfully open-minded than the rest of us? I don't know, but that's not my supposition. The difference is most of it is not expensive. There are not that many gated communities in West Virginia. And that means a kind of integration across education, race, class, many other factors that we are losing in so many other parts of this country.
There's an argument that says that the federal government used to be a body of investment. It spent a lot more as a share of GDP on infrastructure. It spent a lot more as a share of GDP on military and research and development. And that it's essentially gone from being an investment vehicle to an insurance conglomerate. We now spend at least half of the federal budget, last I checked, on Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, veterans benefits, essentially insurance for old people. To what extent does this have anything to do, you think, with the rise of the complacent class, the shift of the federal government from an investment vehicle to an insurance conglomerate?
It's a significant symptom. So in my young childhood, we put a man on the moon in 7 years. Today, sometimes there's talk about building a bridge in maybe 17 years, occasionally seven. It can take 7 years to rename a bridge, because there are so many levels of government or so many regulators involved. We're headed toward a point very rapidly where 80% of the federal budget will be consumed by spending that is essentially locked in through entitlements. One can well debate what should be the level of our budget, but for a long time I have felt a higher percentage of that budget should be discretionary and used to support innovation and investment in our future, and not just security and safety for a lot of people who, frankly, are better off than the national average.
And this is an interesting point, because it suggests that, you know, almost every rich democracy has made a similar choice to spend more and more of its money on social welfare, on universal health care throughout Western Europe, and on retirement policies and pensions. To a certain extent, does it seem, looking around the world, that complacency is a negative externality of progress, that as a country becomes rich, it necessarily spends more money protecting itself, and this is just an outcome that it has to live with, is a slight loss in dynamism?
We see it in Western Europe, we see it in Japan, but it's not just a slight loss in dynamism, it's a major loss in dynamism. And you know, the pain that comes is really the problem, because again, in the short run, we are more secure, we're happier. But one of two things will hit you first. First, either a debt crisis, which has come to some parts of Europe, or your governance will become so dysfunctional, you will one day wake up and look at your government and not know what in the heck happened here. Now, at least one of those...
I can't imagine the feeling.
I'm not aware of the debt crisis yet. There's a pension crisis. There was a homeowner's debt crisis already. We actually did have some debt crises.
Student debt crisis.
State governments, Illinois, bankrupt, yes. But the quality of governance, that decline has come first, and that is right now, in my opinion, proving rather problematic.
Let's talk about parts of the country that don't seem complacent. I see the reaction to Trump's election, the rejuvenation of protests around the country, and I wonder whether, to a certain extent, you see Donald Trump as a kind of vaccine applied to the civic body to flush out complacency, or whether perhaps he is, in a strange way, the most complacent thing that the country could have possibly done.
There's a very good chance that we'll end up being complacency in disguise. Make America great again, not a big, bold, grand vision about the future that you might have found in the early to mid-1960s. Returning to the past, the Eisenhower era, preserve all entitlements, not really be very effective in getting particular things done domestically. And so far, that's what we see. Extreme stasis marketed as extreme change, plus a Twitter account.
So I agree that I think you can definitely interpret the vote for Donald Trump as a vote to reinstill the politics and economics and culture of, say, the mid-1950s. But what about the reaction on the left or the reaction among Democrats? Do you see that there's any way that Trump could somewhat ironically serve to, that in retrospect, in 20 years, we could look back and say, Trump shook the left, shook the Democratic Party out of the shackles of complacency and forced them to become a more focused vision of the sort of complacent version they had settled into in the 90s and 2000s?
Well, that's my hope, but I wouldn't focus on shaking the Democrats as a group. I would focus on shaking Americans, because the complacent class, it's not a party thing. It takes a different form in each party, or also with libertarians. But there was a presumption in this country until not too long ago, either before the crash or maybe before 9/11, that things would simply continue to get better almost on automatic pilot. And slowly but surely, we're seeing the risk of that not being true go up. It still could happen, but the risk actually that we are too stultified, that we are too stagnant, that the quality of our governance has become too low. In a lot of the world, you see liberty retreating rather than advancing, in Russia, in China, in Turkey, parts of the Middle East up in flames. And you go back to 1996, when everything seemed on the right track, and you ask, well, what has happened? And what has happened is we did exactly all the things that we felt good about.
Trump is giving his State of the Union address or something like it tonight, and I wonder, because it seems right now that the president has a budget that he wants to pass, which isn't terrifically revolutionary. It transfers essentially 40-ish percent of the State Department's budget to the Pentagon. At the same time, you have congressional Republicans, Senate Republicans essentially saying right now that they want to pass tax reform, which is going to be some sort of tax cut. And then you have the debate about repeal and replace for Obamacare. So sort of a three-legged stool of Republican economic fiscal policy. What do you think is going to happen?
Obamacare will fundamentally not go away. They may relabel it Trump care or Republican care or modify it, maybe even improve it, though I don't see that in the cards yet, but that will stick. I'm not sure how much taxes will be cut at all. The House and Senate have a hard time agreeing. But even if they are, it's just a kind of play change where every time it's a Republican administration, we cut the taxes. Every time it's a Democratic administration, we raise them up again. And we tell ourselves what a dynamic polity and political debate we have. As you mentioned in your book, the notion that you would debate guacamole with peas as an option. Our politics has become about, like, can you make good guacamole with peas? People agree on the main issues behind all the rhetoric and the insults and the symbolism and the like. And our governments are stuck. We have a lot of federalism. I'm not at all against that. But that means it's very easy to stay stuck because everyone has to agree to undo something. And that's where we are. We had better hope that no major crisis comes along anytime very soon. We are not ready to respond.
I should make sure I understand the guacamole with peas reference.
It's from your book.
It is from that book. No, I hope I remember the reference. I should make sure I understand the point. It's essentially, you're saying there's a bit of a narcissism of the small difference. That,
exactly.
That both parties agree on the guacamole, but they fight to the death on the peas.
And they pretend they don't agree. So how many times did the Republicans vote to repeal Obamacare? Was it 43? I've lost count. 60-something. And now they're here. So it will always look like there's incredible disagreement. We're so polarized. We are in some ways more polarized. That's in the data. But ultimately, the underlying fact, we're older, we have less money to spend, and it's harder to change things because more levels of government and regulators are involved. No one is undoing those basic truths.
Let's look at a locus of dynamism that is a bit controversial, which is the growth in student protests across the country that we've seen in the last few years. On the one hand, I could imagine the argument that says this is a beautiful display of dynamism. These are young people who are taking to the streets and protesting and expressing the American virtue of liberty, etc. On the other hand, I could imagine an argument that says that fundamentally the cause that they're protesting for is very conservative, that they don't want to have their ideological biases challenged in the classroom. Where do you fall? Are the ostensibly optically dynamic protests on college campuses to the good, or is it merely another example of complacency?
I'm cautiously hopeful. I agree with your point. Maybe they're not protesting the right things. They don't have a great sense of urgency. But just having protest at all, we need to be reminded protest is highly inconvenient. And that's one thing we tried to sweep under the rug. You know that movie Selma, 1965, the famous march? Fantastic event. It proved very important for this country. When they did that, you know, they had to close the interstate for several days. They wouldn't do that today. You know, you couldn't get the permits and the permission. So we have bureaucratized protest. It's a national security issue. There's the Park Service, the Secret Service in this town. This space you can't use. Here are the barricades. Here are the lines. My goodness, our protests are themselves a manifestation of bureaucracy. And I'm just hoping any move in the other direction will make this just a little better.
It's interesting. What you were just saying reminded me of Paul Graham, the entrepreneur, the founder of Y Combinator, and an advisor to a very close friend of mine. One of my best friends, in fact, my best friend, is starting a company right now. And he started several different companies. He started a photo app and a video app and a conference chat app. And none of them were particularly successful. And he's at Y Combinator. And Paul Graham, his advisor, tells him, your problem is what you need to do to be a successful entrepreneur is to do something that's a schlep. And in a weird way, I could imagine a jaunty summary of the book saying, we need to fall in love with the schlep. We need to fall out of love with predictability, with the predictable track toward wealth and prosperity, and to do things that are a little bit inconvenient, like the protest, like starting a company that is outside the norm. Would you say that's true?
That's absolutely true. And Silicon Valley, for all of its problems, does have some of the least complacent people in this country. And I would say also that immigrants, on average, are much less complacent than people who were born here or who came here at a very early age. So one way this country has renewed itself in the past is to sweep away former complacencies with further waves of immigration. And I hope we're able to continue this tradition.
I was just going to end on immigration, because this is one area where it's not just guacamole and peas. I think the two, well, certainly Donald Trump and the Democrats have had extremely different ideas about the future of immigration. And you make a really interesting point in the book where you say, it's commonly said among economists that America's intergenerational mobility, which is essentially its upward mobility, is a lot lower than Western Europe's and then Northern Europe's, like Scandinavia and Norway. But in fact, if you look at the upward mobility of immigrants to the United States, it's extremely high, which is to say they enter the country poor and they often work their way into the lower and upper middle class. So we've sort of outsourced our dynamism to immigrants.
Correct. And also the people who move around the country the most are also immigrants, in particular Latinos or Mexican Americans or Mexicans. They're much more willing to move, completely to their credit, but that's something else we've outsourced. It's like, I'll stay here, you move, it's what you came to this country for, you're the one who moves around, I'm the one who stays put. In individual cases, it very often makes sense. Done collectively, it's extremely dangerous.
I mean, you could say, that's such an interesting point, because you could say that in several ways, it is today's immigrants who are upholding in the most exacting way the traditions of American dynamism and the ways of America.
It's actually a lot of the people born in this country who are having trouble assimilating. The immigrants come here, they assimilate right away. Oh, I'm going to move around. I'm going to be ambitious. I'm going to earn a lot of money. I'm going to get a good education. Wonderful. And then some of the rest of us who are maybe a little slower, we don't fit so well into America. And people have the assimilation problem backwards. It's so often people whose ancestors have lived here for some time who don't do that well assimilating to change.
That's great. You talk often on your blog about Straussian readings. First, can you define briefly a Straussian reading for the audience?
A Straussian reading is a reading that is not explicit in the text, but if you read between the lines, you can to some extent find it there. That's an oversimplification. But
a useful oversimplification. And my Straussian reading of the book was that you are making an interesting argument for chaos in a way, or at least a little bit more chaos, a measured injection of chaos into the American system. And I wouldn't go so far as to say that Steve Bannon would be thrilled to read this book because of its celebration of chaos that he seems to really enjoy. But in many ways, in many different elements, it seems that what you're arguing for is a little bit less order and an appreciation for slightly less order in our home lives, in our careers, in our economic policies, and even in our political institutions.
That's correct. And in some ways, I intend this as an optimistic or even reassuring book. It's telling people the bumps that are coming right now, yes, they will hurt, but that's part of a process of renewing dynamism. Two other Straussian readings in my book. One is just the moralizing reading. I didn't try to write this book with a moralizing tone at all. But, you know, there's that quotation, it's in Deuteronomy in the Bible. It's what, chapter 4, line 25 and 26. It refers to the complacent class, and it says they're all going to be destroyed. So I'm lecturing people with my moralizing hat being on, but trying never to let that on. And the other reading, any book you read, always ask, is the author writing about himself or herself? Mm-hmm. And of course I am. And maybe I can tell you now, I took my own complacency quiz, and I came out as complacent. So it's moralizing about myself, and that's another one of the Straussian readings.
Which is the best kind of moralizing. At the end of the book, in the conclusion, you have several predictions about the future, predictions that might be proof of the unshackling of complacency. You predict the possibility that antidepressants for children will fall out of favor in lieu of letting them sort of work out their energies outside, potentially a revolution in cheaper energy to maybe realize some of the, if not necessarily flying car dreams of the 1950s, then maybe the Hyperloop visions of today. I'm particularly interested in your prediction that elite couples will have more children.
That's already the case, by the way.
All right, I'm interested to hear it. So why do you predict this is going to happen?
After I wrote the book and submitted it, for the first time in a long time, the data flipped. Now the gradient for number of children and education, it's flat. It used to be more educated people had fewer kids, but those are now tending to be the longer lasting, more stable families. People who are very wealthy, it's now a kind of trend or in thing to have four kids occasionally more. And I think child rearing is coming back in fashion, maybe slowly. And I also think artificial intelligence and monitoring, which I have mixed feelings about, but it's going to make being a parent a lot easier in some ways, because you'll be able to control the little buggers like never before. So I think birth rates in some countries, at least this one, will turn back up.
So the same way that kitchen technology and dishwashers essentially emancipated or freed up lots of time for home people taking care of the home in the 1950s and 1960s, you see sort of similar technologies coming online that will make child rearing itself more efficient in the near future.
Your pet drone will watch your kid, right? Why not?
That's great. We're done between the two of us, but we'd love to take your questions.
Thank you, Derek.
Thanks, Sally.
I'm happy to start. Thank you. It was a very interesting talk. I didn't hear the beginning, but I'm wondering if the complacency you're talking about is lack of technical change. Most of the time, technical change is labor saving, and we don't really need labor saving devices. People are what we need is a change in social order or change in social institutions so that people have more leisure.
We need changes that make healthcare and education better, more affordable, and more accountable. We haven't had many of those. We can send around more information more quickly than ever before. That is worth something. If you're an academic or a journalist, like the two of us are, it's fantastic. But for most people, the gains are not huge. Like, yes, Facebook is more fun than old-style network TV, but it's not an actual revolution in your life. So I think you're exactly right. Information technology so far, it's improved our leisure. It hasn't created that much new additional opportunity compared to what we had been expecting.
So I'm a member of the Complacent Class. I'm a physician. Insecurity and risk are bad for people's health. They don't like it. They drink, they abuse substances. That's part of the, people are much less secure today than they were in the 1950s when I grew up. And the vote for Trump was a vote to go back to a more secure place. Not everyone is an entrepreneur. Most people are not. But that doesn't mean they have nothing to offer. I was very risk averse. That's why I became a physician. And I think I have something to offer. And you need to get outside the beltway.
You'll be pleased to hear I live outside the beltway.
Not far enough.
Here's the thing. If you try to insulate your society from risk and change, you will create exactly the conditions that have given rise to our opioid epidemic. You have parts of the country which cannot regenerate themselves and where people find it hard to leave. The strategy of lowering risk by eliminating risk is bound to fail, and that's counterintuitive. But healthy societies have to take on some risk simply to minimize stress and anxiety.
You should oppose tenure.
Tenure.
Yeah, she's tenured. No risk there.
Hi. I want to thank you for your book recommendation for Keep From All Thoughtful Men. I have one after the talk to repay that favor, but I wondered if you could talk about like scenario planning instead of these predictions. I wonder if you could talk about how your predictions could go wrong or how people could respond to what you think will happen and maybe a wider range of possibilities, if that makes sense.
Well, one way my predictions could go wrong is if we all simply woke up tomorrow, realized there was something horribly wrong, and fixed it. That is not impossible. It can happen. But the risk of that not happening seems to me to have been rising steadily since about 1999 or 2000. Another way my predictions actually did go wrong was some things happened more quickly than I expected. So I did not expect Trump to win the election. And the original draft of this book, I talk as if, you know, maybe in 5 or 10 years something really strange will happen. Now, I had time to alter that to make it sound more like the present tense, but that's a case where reality was quicker than what I expected, and the underlying dysfunctionality of certain systems was further advanced than I realized. So those are some ways my predictions could go wrong, or in one case have gone wrong.
The subtitle of your book is The Quest for the American Dream.
Self-defeating quest.
My question is, what part has politics played under Bush, Barack Obama, and now Trump in the quest for the American dream? Is it lost? Is it still viable? How do you feel about that?
I'm mostly an optimist. If you look at how much human talent is in this country, it's more than ever before. Most of our institutions are in reasonably good shape. If you look at our businesses, our civil society, our nonprofits, a lot of our families, there's fraying at the edges, to be sure. But I think we are very far from resembling an empire that is falling apart. But there is a wake-up call we need, that there's something about the path we've been on that is a path of decline, and simply holding put is not good enough anymore. But our system is built to favor the status quo. It's in the Federalist Papers. So that's the big issue. It's one reason, arguably, why, say, Canada and Australia are in a somewhat better position than the United States right now. We have more checks and balances. It's usually a good thing. It's not at all points in time a good thing.
Thank you.
So I want to ask just a very basic question as to why you chose complacency for the guiding framework of this book. Because when I look at post-war America, I see radical changes in the economy and labor market, not necessarily radical changes in American attitudes. I think the desire for stability seems quite constant. So if that's the case, what extent can we talk about complacency as a policy failure? And if so, do you think looking to countries that employ a more flexicurity model that both promote creative destruction and also offer some measure of a social safety net as a good model and guide for what we can do here?
There's a lot in that question. Maybe I'll focus on the first part. I think in American history, there is a fundamental shift after the mid-60s to mid-70s. That's a remarkably violent time. Riots, demonstrations in prisons, on campuses, the Vietnam War. We have a president who really tries to wreck the Constitution, Richard Nixon. Crime rises to levels people would not have imagined earlier. And as a nation, we ended up recoiling from this. And, you know, thank goodness, we decided we would make this country far more peaceful, more tolerant, much safer. We succeeded beyond what almost anyone had expected. But in the process, we, along some dimensions, went too far. The 80s and 90s were these wonderful decades. And I think there's a generational issue now with Trump. People who are old enough to remember Nixon and earlier times, I'm not saying they like Trump, but they feel a bit we've been through something before. And they're less terrified that this is somehow like the end of democracy, the onset of fascism. I think the chance of that is very, very low. That really doesn't worry me much. I worry we're in for a big bout of bad governance. Whereas people who've only seen the 80s and 90s, if it's because of your age, being an immigrant, and it's like, my goodness, what has happened? Where is the America that I loved? Well, America has always been screwed up, right? Look at the Great Depression or Reconstruction or the Civil War or, you know, King Philip's War in 1675. Go back to whenever you want. This is the real America in some ways reasserting itself.
Great, thank you.
Hi, I think my question may be a rewording of the previous question. When I listened to your examples, the two examples that came up were the cost of housing, the cost of education. To what extent is this not necessarily the rise of a complacent class, but the rise of inequality in the US? To what extent is the increasing complacency rather an increased perception of the cost of risk?
Well, those are different sides of the same coin. So inequality going up, and let's talk about real consumption inequality, inequality in the actual quality of your life. Where you can live is critically important for the education your children will get, even for your health care, possibly for your diet, the peers around you, the kind of future you have, the kind of expectations your children will form. So as we've cemented in basic institutions, it's been really good for a lot of Americans, including probably most, maybe even all of the people in this room. But we're also choking off mobility for the rest of America, immigrants aside, but maybe, Derek, you want to come in on this too. You've written on a lot of related issues.
I really like the way that you framed that, the perceived cost of risk. I think that clearly has something to do with a lot of the stuff we talked about, the perceived cost of risk of moving to a really expensive place. I think that, you know, it's always important. What I think about in the sweep of the book is the trade-off and whether I think it's worth it. Because, you know, like Tyler was saying, in the 1960s, 1970s, we were going through a period of strife that today, by comparison, would seem near apocalyptic. And so it seems only natural that to a certain extent Americans would recoil and try to instill policies and cultural norms that would make America seem safer. And in so many ways, I think that because of a lot of these welfare policies, I personally think that these welfare policies have been really good for raising the life satisfaction of the poor, and I think that we have a moral obligation to do so. But I do think that one thing that's clearly happened is that the growth in inequality, particularly since the late 1970s, has created a scenario where you have a handful of extremely rich neighborhoods that have passed local housing policies that make it very, very difficult for middle-class people to move close to those areas, enjoy the fruit of that productivity growth, and that a lot of the problems that we see in Tyler's book and beyond come from a unfortunate lack of interest in these parts of the country to build more housing and allow more people to essentially enjoy the fruits of productivity there.
Thank you. Yeah, following up a little on the last question, I was struck by your point originally that the country is becoming more and more homogeneous and people don't move because everything's so much the same. And what I hear and read is so much the opposite, that we are rising inequality, not just among individuals, but between different regions of the country. You have well-off young people congregating in certain urban areas that are dynamic. You have dying rural communities. Is it really that everything is the same, or is it more that we have segregated ourselves and people are trapped?
Well, where the GDP is, things are more and more the same than they used to be. Where the GDP isn't, is more and more different. And that's just another way of putting the problem. So the areas with and without a lot of GDP have never been more different. Decline and rise, Silicon Valley versus some communities in the Rust Belt. But American cities have lost a variety of their distinct flavors, and we are in this regard more homogenized at the national level, where you have elites, education, and a fair amount of wealth.
I would just add really quickly that there was a period in the early 20th century where migration patterns within the United States, domestic migration, tended to be poor to rich areas. So you had lots of families moving toward GDP. But now one thing that you see when you look at domestic migration patterns is that it tends to be from richer areas to poorer areas, or more specifically, or more top of mind, expensive housing to less expensive housing, particularly in the Sun Belt. So that suggests that seems to me to be another chip in the argument that an enormous factor behind the loss of America's mojo is the fact that housing prices are so expensive in the most productive areas, which limits the ability of domestic migrants to move
just
there.
Is it really the problem that people will not move as well as much as they used to between Washington and San Francisco, between different parts of the America where the GDP is, or is it more that people in the poor areas don't see a way out, can't migrate from
it's the latter.
Areas to booming areas?
I mean, I could move to San Francisco. That's not a problem.
Right.
I'm probably not going to do it. If I can do it, it's fine. If I don't do it, it's not a problem. But if you're in a declining Rust Belt community and you're looking around for options, and there's a variety of reasons, it could be as something as locally specific benefits or occupational licensing, the price of housing. It could just be your orientation. People who are educated are more likely to be mobile than people who are not well educated. That's a big factor too. All of those have pushed together in the direction of making Americans people who more or less stay put.
Thank you very much for an extremely interesting discussion, which I was very much looking forward to. And then this morning I read an op-ed in the New York Times by Roger Cohen titled "The Madness of Crowds," which I think links to your talk, and if you allow me, I would like to quote one or two sentences and then ask my question, okay? It goes like this. People notice that the attempt to squeeze the last cent of profit out of any operation has also squeezed the last trace of sentiment out of what passes for human interaction. They see that technology serves relentless efficiency, and somewhere in that efficiency, life gets joyless and existence precarious. They note that good unions, retirement benefits, manufacturing jobs, overtime and healthcare get eliminated or curtailed in pursuit of that last cent in profits. My question is, do you think that this widespread sentiment that the system is rigged and working in favor of only the privileged elite has something to do with the development of stagnation and the feeling of impotence of people to move in the way you would consider favorable?
I don't think the system is rigged in the sense of there being any kind of conspiracy. I think most people in the system are in some way meaning well and acting in their self-interest, but also believing they're bettering the interests of society and in the short run doing a fairly responsible job. But you simply end up with a setting where job creation is low, wage growth is low, moving around and dynamism and innovation are relatively low. And over time, all of that has human consequences. Foreign competition comes along. There's always been foreign competition. The question is, what new things can you do to outrace foreign competition? Well, we're not doing a great job at the new things, again, information technology aside. So that's a bit of a different framing than what you presented.
But would you think that this can explain the crisis of 2008? Can that be explained by most of the people working with good intentions and under fair conditions? Or does it correspond to a model where some people take ruthless advantage of all sorts of loopholes, and when the thing crashes, leave the bag to the people that own houses or loses their job or lose their houses? Is that not a justified interpretation of that people feel the system is rigged against them?
Right, that's not really a question in my book. But my opinion is there's plenty of data showing that the banks that pushed the most subprime mortgages on people also lost a lot of money themselves and held an especially high proportion of such mortgages. That we pretty much know. So no, I don't think it's mainly an evil conspiracy. There were mistakes in the system, too much confidence, too much complacency. You could say a bad regulatory framework and a perfect storm of a lot of negatives coming together. But that is off the topic of the book, mostly.
We have time for two more questions.
Okay. I would agree with that, gentlemen. The special interests have really given a sense of being overwhelmed and having the system held down by those who have already.
But we're the special interests, right?
Some of us are and some of us are not. It varies. But the point I wanted to get to is that what you're describing are the dynamics of many cultures in the past,
sure,
where those who have want to protect what they've got. That's almost human nature,
sure,
so to speak. And those who are coming up are trying to figure out what those who have are willing to put out to buy.
Sure.
Now, here's what I'm getting to. I think we need more dialogue and more stimulation of imagination as to what it is we might want. In other words, there's nothing out there to offer us enough vision to want to take risks. So we get that sense of being overwhelmed. And that's what I think more of the literary people in our culture, mm-hmm, instead of complaining, and it's good to complain a little bit, but offering us more of the dynamics of how we get out of this mess.
Sure, absolutely.
Father and Derek, thank you for being here. It's a very enjoyable discussion. You posited during your talk that it is beneficial for individuals to sort of move towards stability and prosperity, and that creates stagnation, complacency. At the same time, for the society, it's better when there is a lot more dynamism. So is there a contradiction between what's good for the individuals versus what's good for society? And if so, then what would create necessary conditions for people to do what's better for society but not necessarily good for them? Is there a role for the government or some other external force that would sort of force them to do counterintuitive things?
It's a collective action problem. This also gets back to the last question. I have a long list of policy reforms I would like to recommend. Derek and I agree on many of them. But I don't think that's the right question at this point. The right question is, why is this country so uninterested in them? Not what does my list look like? Well, deregulate housing so we can build more higher density neighborhoods near wealthier neighborhoods. Of course, I could give you 20 other recommendations, nominal GDP targeting, whatever. The question is, why are we debating other issues altogether rather than talking about what kinds of changes we need? And I think that's ultimately a psychological, cultural, spiritual, civilizational question. And I think of my book as a kind of initial diagnostic to figuring out what's gone wrong with us. We have a bunch of good ideas. For the most part, they're not on the agenda. How about repealing the mortgage interest deduction? How many groups of homeowners are there forming lobbies to get this done? I'm not aware that there's one.
But again, it would be counterintuitive action, right?
Yes.
Why would anyone do that? So
that's
what,
right.
What would force you to do it? People don't act in an irrational manner.
Societies have unique moments where the forces of their own cultures carry them forward in beneficial ways, and the United States has had an especially long run in this regard. By no means do I believe it's over. But our history, in turn, has had hiccups, bumps, earthquakes, wars, and I think we're at one now. So the 80s and 90s, in my view, were a kind of illusion. A turning point starts around 99, 2000, and the new bumps are coming, and the traditional problems of our past will in some new way reemerge and bite us very badly. And I'm also trying to lay out a vision through which we can see there being redemption at the end of this long road.
That's all we have time for. Thank you all very, very much.
Thank you, Derek.